Molly Roberts. I'm an assistant professor at UC San Diego. So thanks to Orange for having us. I didn't wear orange on purpose, but I realize it was appropriate now. So technology can be used, and we've heard just a lot of really interesting examples of how technology can be used to facilitate governance and accountability. But it can also be used to evade accountability and to deceive. So I study censorship and propaganda in China, and this may be sort of the largest selective suppression of human expression in history. So we might think about, you know, selective deletion of social media posts, of information, that this is a really large system. There are many different ways in which the Chinese government tries to control information online, including removing social media posts, creating the Great Firewall to selectively block social media things, and search filtering, so reorganizing search to put different information at the top and different information at the bottom. And this is really facilitated by technology, and it's often invisible to consumers. So this is a very large operation. We estimate there are about hundreds of thousands of censors, government censors. Many censors are hired at social media firms. There's also a large internet police that sort of oversees this operation. And there are rumors of, and I'll talk about this in a little bit in a second, maybe millions of people that are hired to astroturf or to post things online at the direction of the government. So I'm going to talk a little bit. We've done a lot of different studies of this that have appeared in a lot of different places on both what is the content of censorship and what's the content of online propaganda. And I've also done some work on what its impact are. So I'm going to talk really about what the content and of censorship and propaganda are in China today. So most people, when they think about censorship and propaganda in China, they think, well, maybe there are two different objectives. One might be to stop criticism of the state, to stop people saying bad things about the government. The other that a lot of people cite is to stop protest events or to stop people from gathering. We know that social media facilitates online and on-the-ground action. And what we find really is that the Chinese government allows quite a bit of criticism online. They delete very little criticism online. And really, a lot of the censorship and propaganda efforts of the Chinese government is to stop protests. And if you think about this makes a lot of sense. There are huge costs for the government to stop criticism. So if we think about in democracies, you get a lot of feedback through elections. Authoritarian regimes like China, you have trouble collecting information about what people like and what people don't like about your government. And so having information online is really useful. And we see that the government has set up a lot of institutions to sort of listen to what people are saying about policies and about local governments so that they can improve them. On the other hand, stopping protest events, there's a huge benefit. This is probably the number one danger for authoritarian regimes is protests. And so stopping these types of protests is really beneficial. And the cost of this, you already gotten this feedback, so there's not a lot of cost. So in summary, sort of just to summarize all of our findings, basically is that censorship and online propaganda is about setting the agenda online in China. So it's about taking people away from talking about protest events and talking about other things. And it's not really about winning arguments. So a lot of people think about propaganda and censorship as, you know, making people like the government more or making people, you know, persuading the people to like the government. That's not as much of what we find. We find it's mostly to change the subject. So the first study I'll talk about is we basically collected millions of social media posts in 2011 before the Chinese government was able to censor and remove them online. And the way we did this is we downloaded the content the instant it appears online, and we went and revisited this content later to see whether it was taken down or censored. And then we had a whole bunch of like censored social media posts and non-censored social media posts, and we'd use some machine learning methods to try to figure out what are the differences between these two things. So this is one example of what you might see when you encounter censorship online in China. So this is like if you went back to a URL that used to be a blog post, but then you would find this error that says, you know, the page you requested is temporarily down. How about you go look at another page? And this one in particular is not too ambiguous because it has Jingjing, one of Chinese cartoon internet polices, in the corner. It certainly has to do with sort of internet policing. So what we found at first was that, well, something that really surprised us when we started looking at this was that both censorship and post volume are bursty. So think about social media, everybody talks about something all the time, right? So like all of a sudden everybody's talking about one subject. That's true in China too. And what happens is that when everybody starts talking about this one subject and it relates to a collective action event, then the government starts censoring it. So this is just one time plot of between January and July of 2011. We are following this county. It's called Zhengcheng. And in June of 2011, there are these huge riots in Zhengcheng. This pregnant migrant worker was beaten by local police. And there are big, big, big protests. We see that, the blog posts are not censored before the June, and then all of a sudden everybody's talking about this event and a lot of these things come down. And we saw this as a pattern over and over, is that when everybody starts talking about a protest event, when a protest is going on, then the red, which is the censorship, or a lot of those posts are getting taken down. So we monitored 85 different topic areas over this time period, January to July of 2011, and we identified the real world events associated with each of these different bursts. And what we found was that government censors all posts, regardless of whether they're supportive or critical of the state, within these volume bursts that are associated with events that had collective action potential, which are either protests on the ground or people who have organized protests in the past, so like activists, those types of things. So these are the 87 events that we found within our data set. We found that there are a lot of policy and news events. This is censorship magnitude, which is the difference between censorship within the burst versus outside of the burst. We found that a lot of policy events were not censored at all. So even very controversial policies, discussions of the one-child policy, migrant worker policies, which are really controversial in China, a lot of stuff that was really critical of the Chinese government online. But the things that were mainly censored, really, really highly censored, were things like the protests in Inner Mongolia over where these, huge protests happened in 2011, the arrest of Ai Weiwei, which was also during our time period. These were things that that were mainly censored. But then after we did this study, we were a little bit worried that we were missing some things about censorship. So one of the things that we did afterwards was we decided, well, let's go and download a social media platform and try to figure out what are the mechanisms of censorship and what are the posts that we're seeing when we're studying this and what are the posts that we're missing. We found that there's like a bit of a flowchart of how posts get published online. If you look kind of at the background, you look at the back of how censorship is working on a lot of these forums. One is when somebody submits a post for posting, either it could be published immediately online, in which case it would either remain online or it would be censored later. So that was what we were studying before. Or it might not be published immediately. It might be caught in like some type of keyword and never published. And in that case, it would go to review, and either then it would be published later after it was reviewed, or it would be never see the light of day. So in our observational study, we were studying these sets of posts, which had seen the light of day at some point, but we had really missed a whole bunch of different posts that were automatically deleted, and we wouldn't have seen them in the study before. So to get around this, we conducted an experiment where we conducted sort of three rounds of experiments posting social media posts on the Chinese internet. So we selected 100 of the top social media sites in China. We created two accounts on each of these social media sites. We then wrote 1,200 unique social media posts, and we posted these online and saw if they were censored. So we'd assigned these to four treatment conditions based on what we'd saw before. So either they were about a collective action event happening at the time or about another event, policy-related event at the time. And within each of these events, we posted things that were supportive of the government and things that were critical of the government. And we based our writings based off of things that we'd had seen already online in the past. And then we recorded whether the post was published immediately or if it was held for review. And we checked to see if it was subsequently censored. What we found is that there were large, we found basically the same thing we found in the observational study, is that posts that were about collective action events were much, much more likely to be censored than posts that were not about collective action events. So when we wrote posts about Panshu protests, which were these protests where the local government had grabbed land from citizens, if we wrote about that, then that would be taken down in a much higher rate in comparison to other things we wrote about during the same time period. Similarly, when we talked about Tibetan self-immolation protests or protests in Xinjiang or anything about Ai Weiwei, these things would be censored in comparison to other things. But interestingly, there was basically no treatment effect, no difference between censorship between posts that we wrote that were supportive of the government and posts that we wrote that were against the government. And that was really interesting to us. So within each of these different topic areas, there wasn't a difference in censorship between supportive and against. So it was really that the government's trying to take away all information about protest events, regardless of whether they were supportive or against the government. Okay, so the third paper I just want to talk about briefly is this sort of what we think about as reverse censorship or astroturfing, putting things online. And this is a recent study that we conducted where we looked to see, we wanted to study, what was the Chinese government posting online? This is really hard to study. There have always been rumors of this. And we studied it by using basically leaked email archive of a local propaganda office in China. So this leaked archive was posted by a blogger online, and it contained emails where workers who were 50 Cent Party members, if you think about it, or online propaganda workers, were claiming credit for their 50 Cent posts by emailing the propaganda department and saying, I posted these online, give me credit for them. And so there are about 2,000 emails within this email archive in 2013, 2014, and about half of them contained these emails where people were claiming credit for their posts. And we went through this by hand and using some automated methods, and we basically extracted about 40,000 different unique social media posts that had been posted online during this time period at the direction of the government. And so what people have always thought about the 50 Cent Party in China is that it's there to sort of argue and debate with government critics. So people say, okay, 50 Cent Party are people who counter government criticism online. And a lot of people online get accused of being 50 Cent Party members if they say anything that's sort of mean about the government and then come back and say, well, actually, the government's really awesome. So what we found was that the 50 Cent Party does not argue or engage on controversial issues, but really, they're using a 50 Cent Party post to distract or to redirect public attention. And in particular, most of the 50 Cent Party posts we extracted from this email archive were sort of cheerleading or saying positive things about China, not even necessarily about the government. So things like, you can do it, or, yay China, like these types of things were mostly like a lot of what was going on within the post. But that they were focused during time periods that were really sensitive to the government, and so they were sort of distracting from other things that might have been going on. So we estimated the distribution of these posts over 5 different categories. The first were taunting of foreign countries and arguing praise and criticism, which was the prevailing view of what the 50 Cent Party was doing. And then we also estimated how many of the posts were sort of non-argumentative praise or suggestions, so just praising leaders, or factual reporting, saying like, this event is going on, the government's doing it, or cheerleading, so saying these positive things about the government. And we did this not only with just the leaked 50 Cent posts that I was telling you about, the 40,000, but also with posts that we guessed were 50 Cent Party members outside of this locality based on the patterns that we saw within the data set. We basically found that across this is across the leaked emails, but also other out-of-county predictions, so predicted accounts that we thought were 50 Cent Party based on the patterns we saw within the data set, we found that most of the focus of the 50 Cent Party was focused on cheerleading and not really taunting or arguing with critics. So just to sort of conclude, it seems like the strategy of censorship and propaganda in China is not really to engage on controversial issues. It's to allow criticism that's useful for the government and not to really argue with critics or take on critics, because that just brings more attention to that issue. Rather, it's to sort of censor real-world collective action events that are directly threaten the government and its accountability and make it be more accountable, and also to distract with cheerleading and positive valence, so just to make sort of the internet be a little bit more positive. So we usually think that autocrats sort of will want to decrease knowledge of common grievances and decrease criticism to increase the cost of coordination. But we found basically that China seems to differentiate between 2 different types. One is like grievances, so criticism, which is allowed, and in fact that's useful from the government perspective, but collective action, which is not allowed. In general, I think that especially with the 50 Cent Party, there's a lot of psychology research that shows that sort of arguments never win arguments, but distraction does, and I think that's the government seems to be using that to sort of reroute people to different types of conversations online.